Indian music is like a vast ocean with many different moods. Sometimes it's joyous, sometimes it's sad. Sometimes it's very powerful, vigorous, strong, yet peaceful. As a musician, I feel music is to be felt. You may not have a lot of knowledge, but then you feel it. See what it does to you. When you come to watch an Indian music concert, you come to see a beautiful thing being created. Sometimes you are a part of it, sometimes you're not. You enjoy the rapport, how well two musicians can come together, how beautifully they can connect. Age is no bar, experience is no bar, instruments are different, but that's not a problem. Together, they create something beautiful called Indian music. Indian music comes from Samved, Vedic music, or Margi Sangeet, as it was known, was devotional. Most of the hymns and ruchas were chanted in this style. The lyrics were composed in Sanskrit and were addressed to the Almighty.
The first sound that a man uttered was Om. The nada, which is the basis for all our music. The seven notes exist just like in any other music in the world, plus the sharp notes and the flat notes exist. We have shrutis, which are 22 in numbers. These together are very intelligently and scientifically used in what we know as parental or father scales, known as tarts or melakratas. In North India, 10 tarts. In South India, 72 melakratas. These are the parental scales on which ragas and raganis are classified.
What is a raga? Is it a composition? Is it a melody? Does it have any fixed form of its own? Or it's just an improvisation?
Well, I don't think I'm really the most qualified person to answer that question, but fortunately, recently I had friends from America. One went and interviewed the great sitar maestro Pandit Ravi Shankar about the same question. I can only tell you what he said.
I usually explain it by saying what a raga is not. For instance, a raga is not a composition, not just a melody or a song or a scale or a key, but it is all of this together. First of all, you see, you have to remember that we have got, according to the northern Hindustani system, 10 scales. And on these scales, these thousands and thousands of ragas are based. And each of these ragas, whether they are 5-note ragas or 6-note ragas or 7-note ragas or permutation combination of all these, they have their own ascending and descending structure. And with the usage of microtones, which we call shrutis, and all other embellishments, the raga really comes into life, but not really. Life is given by the guru. No, unless you learn from the guru properly, a raga can never be alive.
But has a raga got a fixed form?
Well, raga has got some fixed do's and don'ts. It has to adhere to its main principles. But at the same time, what an artist does with the raga is completely, you know, he's free to do whatever he wants, depending upon his mood and the audience. And each raga has got its own personality, what we call rasa, which means mood. So the artist can give his own interpretation also, which means we improvise all the time, you know. Improvisation plays a very important part. And that's why no matter how many times an artist performs a raga, can never be exactly the same. It will be always a little different.
They say that ragas portray different moods and notes can be seen as different colors. Does this mean that you see forms or visuals when you play your music?
Very interesting question, because this is one of the very, very important features of our music, rather unique in the world, where each raga has got its specific mode. And those ragas are connected with the timings of the day, which is very, very important. Some are specially sung or played in the early morning to convey devotional mood, you know, and prayerful mood. Then there are certain ragas which are played in the evening, in the night, which convey romantic mood. And different emotions are there. For instance, I go on the stage, I know what raga I'm going to play, and I know the mood of that raga. Then naturally I can visualize certain things which are connected with that mood, which scene or the place I had seen sometimes back and which was registered in my mind, I recollect it. And that sort of inspires me, you know, to create the mood of that raga. But still then I have got a very strong feeling. This is something which I call take-off point, the beginning of our journey. And our destination is something else. The audience reaction is so important that all quality or the standard of a performance depends on that. Because this music is not written. What we play, it is all created there. And what we expect from the audience is that they should be at the same wavelength, same tuning. They should feel the same thing what the artist is feeling. So if these all things are combined together, then a situation is created, what I call the destination, where the rag, the musician, the instruments, and the audience, they all merge together, and the whole atmosphere doesn't remain a particular auditorium or a place, it becomes a rag. And I feel that's a situation where the listeners are experiencing the bliss, the same bliss which the artist is experiencing. They are not there to be entertained or come there to take it as an enjoyment or entertainment sort of thing. It's a bliss, and both of them, the listeners and the artist, become together, emerge together, and that is the ultimate, I think.
So as I was telling you earlier, music was in those days never used as an entertainment art form. It was very closely connected to the temples. But I think later on, Hazrat Amir Khusro was the one who brought the music to the royal courts. Amir Khusro was a very great Sufi, He was a student of another Sufi, Hazrat Nizamuddin Aulia. He was also a member of the court of Emperor Alauddin Khilji. And that was somewhere around 13th century AD. Hindustani classical music owes a great deal to Hazrat Amir Khusro. His contribution to its growth is multifaceted. Even though his mother tongue was Persian, because of his Turkish descent, he acquired fluency in Sanskrit and Hindi languages at a very young age. And his knowledge of Persian music enabled him to combine it with Qawwali form and create a religious music we know as Sufiana Kalam. He's also supposed to have studied Prabandh Gayaki under Gopal Nayak and then combined it with Qawwali singing to give us the first secular form of music known as Khayal. It was a natural composite flowering of Hindu and Muslim culture. There is a general belief that as early as 9th century there existed a kind of music which was closest to our present-day khayal. This is recorded in the works of great scholars like Matang and in Sharangdev's Sangeet Ratnakar. They mention certain types of composition known as Sadharani Geeti, which are closest to khayal as we know it today. According to Matang, Sadharani Geeti was an eclectic style of composition which combined the charming features of all other styles. The predominant use of Bhinna brought it closer to Khayal, and the Sadharani Geeti singers used Gamaka, which we know to be the most important feature of Khayal. Khayal is a Persian word which means imagination. It's also derived from a Sanskrit word khela, which means a dramatic performance, or khelpada, which basically means a sportive, playful style. Khayal incorporates the classicism of Dhrupad, the romanticism of folk music, and the religious aspect of Qawwali singing. It's a classic case of Desi music rising to the status of classical music. In a nutshell, Qawwali, Dhrupad singing, Prabandh Sangeet and folk music have combined together to give us a very lyrical, melodious, spontaneous, beautiful, playful, rhythmic style known as Khayal. After the death of Amir Khusro, Khayal faded away and Dhrupad reigned supreme. But it did not die out completely, even though it was overshadowed by Dhrupad. Dhrupad is the most ancient form of classical music of India. Its importance is in the rigid discipline that is imposed in the rendition of a raga. It is a very heroic, aggressive, and very expressive style, with a special emphasis on rhythm. Dhrupad was made popular by one of the greatest singers of our history, Mia Tansen. He was one of the nine jewels of the court of Emperor Akbar. In fact, he studied under one of the greatest sages, Swami Haridas. And this here is the platform where Mia Tansen used to sit and sing for hours. And Emperor Akbar used to sit up there and listen to him. You see, even now you can hear the music of Tansen emanating, reverberating through these stones, paying homage to his glory. Khayal was kept alive by the efforts of Ustad Sadarang and Ustad Adarang. Even though they were Dhrupad singers, they still taught Khayal to a lot of their disciples and also composed a lot of Bada and Chota Khayals in the popular ragas of that time. Sultan Hussein Sharqi of Jaunpur is also credited with the revival of Khayal Gaiki. Apart from him and Ustad Sadarang and Adarang, Ustad Nathan Pir Baksh and Ustad Hassu and Haddu Khan Sahab also helped popularize and establish Khayal as an accepted form of music. Many scholars believe that the credit for the creation of Khayal cannot be given to any one single person. They feel that it's been a continuous process of evolution. The rigid, precise framework of Margi Sangeet must have slowly fused with the gay abundance and freedom of Desi Sangeet, thus creating a confluence. And then with the passage of time, the merger of this classicism and romanticism created a distinct style, Khayal, which was unique in its own right. In the later part of the century, Dhrupad conceded the place of honor to Khayal, which became the major force and tradition. And also thanks to the royal patronage by the Maharajas and great considerable leeway available in improvising in Khayal, great musicians were able to flourish and create their own individual style. Guru Shishya Parampara, the passing of knowledge from a teacher to a disciple and to his disciple and so on, was responsible for the passing of these individual styles by the great musicians to their students, which, when passed on from student to student to student, established a very distinct individual style. And there were many such styles, which were basically known as schools, or the most common word in India is gharanas.
Zakir ji, how many gharanas are there?
There is Jaipur gharana, Agra gharana, Patiala gharana, Kirana gharana, there are so many of them. And I think it will be better if I tell you about them one by one.
No.
Gwalior Gharana is considered to be the fountainhead from which other gharanas originated. One of the prime examples of this is Ustad Ghagge Khudabaksh of Agra, who came and studied under Ustad Haddu and Hassu Khan Sahab and took Khayal Gayaki to Agra. Gwalior Gharana Gayaki was very simple in its approach. The fusion of sur and laya was not as complex as it would be, let's say, in Jaipur or Patiala Gharanas. Lots of intricate patterns of swaras were missing, but it was very complementary to the architecture of Gwalior. In other words, majestically simple. Special emphasis was given to laya in Gwalior Gayaki, and the originality of bandish was fanatically maintained in this style. The constant touching of sam gave the rendering a very dramatic and clear structural form. The use of meen was pronounced, and a vocalist was required to sing in pure akar. Some of the most famous exponents of Gwalior Gharanas are the founder Ustad Haddu Hassu Khan Sahab, of course, in present time, the great Kumar Gandharv.
Sauda, la, nagai, sauda. Maria, Gaelo, Maricab. Cavana Badaria, Cavan Badaria, Badaria, Gaelo, Maricab. Badaria, Gaelo, Maride, Oberta, Maride.
Amer Fort, the fort near which the Pink City of Jaipur was built. It's also the home of the famous Gaiki Ang Jaipur Gharana. This style has become one of the most popular form of Gaiki in modern times. The performers of this particular style are found in all parts of India, from Jaipur all the way south in Karnataka. You can hear this particular style by such stalwarts as Nivriti Bua Sarnayak, Kishori Amonkar, and the great Pandit Mallikarjun Mansoor. Jaipur Gharana Gaiki was popularized by the great exponent Ustad Alladia Khan Sahab. He was then followed by Bhurji Khan Sahab and Manji Khan Sahab. In the middle of this century, two of the most famous female vocalists followed this style, Kesarbai Kerkar and Mogubai Kurdikar. Jaipur Gharana's Gaiki approach to Khayal Gaiki is very different than other Gharanas. The use of Alap is very limited and they use Ragas which are not commonly sung in other Gharanas. Sur and Laya are very beautifully combined in this Gharana. The Bol Ang, the Baat Ang, and to be able to come back to some from the bandish is very beautifully achieved in this Gharana.
Thank you.
Kirana Gharana's roots can be traced as far back as Ustad Bande Ali Khan Sahab. Originally, this Gharana was known as the family of Beankars, but in recent times, Ustad Abdul Karim Khan Sahab brought to it the recognition of vocal Gharana. Kirana Gharana features all aspects of Gaiki Ang. Great importance is paid to Swara and Alap. But at the same time, the mood of the Raga is very carefully maintained. And of course, one of the most attractive features of this Gharana is the use of popular Ragas, which creates mass appeal for this Gharana. Some of the most famous exponents of Kirana Gharana are Ustad Abdul Wahid Khan Sahab, Ustad Abdul Karim Khan Sahab, Sawai Gandharv Ji, Hira Bhai Barodekar, Gangubai Hangal, and in present time, of course, the ever popular Pandit Bhimsen Joshi.
Maldarabam, maldarabam. सदा रंग घर का जोर का दूर मन
पटियाला घराना गायकी, as the name suggests, it was set up in Patiala. More correctly, it was set up in the Darbar of the Maharaja of Patiala by two very famous singers of that time, Ustad Aliya Fattu Khan Sahab. Their real names were Fateh Ali Bakhsh and Ustad Ali Bakhsh Khan Sahab. Patiala Gharana Gayaki, just like Agra Gharana, had very close contacts with the Drupad Ang style. So therefore you find a lot of features of Drupad Ang in Patiala Gharana Gayaki, like use of complicated tals, a special attention paid to the dexterity in the performance, and very, very beautiful and fluent use of Sargam Gayaki. Many distinguished singers followed Ustad Aliya and Ustad Fattu Khan Sahab in the carrying on of the tradition of Patiala Gharana, such as Ustad Ashik Ali Khan Sahab, Ustad Umaid Ali Khan Sahab, and the legendary larger-than-life figure of Ustad Bade Ghulam Ali Khan Sahab. In modern times, we have singers like Nirmala Devi, Bade Ghulam Ali Khan Sahab's own son, Ustad Munawwar Ali Khan Sahab. But there is something special about Bade Ghulam Ali Khan Sahab. His gayaki transcended the requirements of the gharana that he is imbibed in. It is very difficult to explain, but I think you would understand what I mean when you hear him sing.
Ah!
Agra, the historical city which has given to the world two of the most artistically beautiful expressions. One, of course, is the Taj, and the other one is the Khayal Gaiki of Agra Gharana. Agra Gharana is probably one of the oldest and most beautiful Khayal Gaiki Ang. It still maintains the Dhrupad style of improvising in a performance. A very strict discipline is maintained in the rendition of a raga, and a lot of attention is paid to the aesthetics in this gharana. Alapchari is the most redeeming feature of the Agra Gharana Gaiki. And when they move on to the faster tempo compositions, Shringar Ras is very prominent. The special movements of Khatka, Mazamiri, very complicated Layakari, and so on. Very beautiful features of Agra Gharana. Lively, moving style, Gaiki. The Khayal Gaiki was brought to Agra from Gwalior by Ustad Ghagge Khuda Baksh Khan Sahab, and since then it has been performed by some of the greatest musicians of this century, like Ustad Vilayat Hussain Sahab, Ustad Khadim Hussain Khan Sahab, Aftab-e Mausiqi Ustad Fayyaz Khan Sahab, Sharafat Hussain Khan Sahab, Latafat Hussain Khan Sahab, Dinkar Kaikini, K.G. Ginde. The list of great performers of this particular Gaiki is endless.
Kahe ho, 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 kahe ho
Mewati Gharana is considered to be the offshoot of both Gwalior and Jaipur styles. Although relatively young, this Gharana has achieved great popularity and acceptance as one of the major Khayal Gayaki Gharanas. Mewati Gharana Gayaki has some religious attributes. In fact, a lot of the compositions are taken from Vedas and Shlokas and Padas and Upadesh, and very much importance is paid to words of the compositions. Emphasis on Swara is very prominent, and there is a special feeling towards bringing out the actual mood of a raga in this gharana. The influence of such great geniuses as Ustad Haddu Hassu Khan Sahab, Ustad Ghagge Nazir Baksh, and Ustad Bade Ali Khan Sahab is very prominent in Mewati gharana. This style was then carried on in the present day time by such great singers as Pandit Jyotiram, Motiram, Maniram, and of course one of the most eloquent singers of our present times, Pandit Jasraj.
Charan ke
Ustad Nisar Hussain Khan Sahab is another example of a great master transcending the needs of a gharana. In this case, it is the Sahaswan gharana which was supposed to be the continuation of the old Rampur gharana. Some people say that it was in fact Sahaswan gharana which was the old gharana and Rampur was the continuation. But that is the point which we won't debate on.
Thank you.
Ustad Nisar Hussain Khan Sahab epitomizes the specialities of Sahaswan Gharana. Beautiful use of boltan, bolbant, behlav, and some of the finest rendition of Tarana Gayaki are very prominent in this Gharana. And some of the most famous Ustads of this Gharana are Ustad Inayat Hussain Khan Sahab, of course Nisar Hussain Khan Sahab, Ustad Hafiz Ahmed Khan Sahab, and Ustad Ghulam Mustafa Khan Sahab. Individual creativity, as Ravi Shankar ji pointed out to us, is one of the most important aspects of Khayal Gayaki, and this is best expressed in the Gayaki of Ustad Amir Khan Sahab. He created his own individual style and put a stamp on Khayal Gayaki, which to this day is followed by some of the most talented singers of our time. Is the mother of Indian music. Tala is definitely the father. Tala is the Indian word for rhythm. There are more than 365 different talas. The concept of tala emerged from Samveda, It is said that in the olden days, the hymns were chanted to very simple rhythmic cycles. And then in 13th century, the great musician-writer Sharangdeva evolved an elaborate system of talas, which had beats ranging from 4 to 108. Tal is many things. It is at one time a complex organization of differing beats in multiple groupings, which are known as taka. Well, there are slow, which is vilambit takas, and drut, which is fast takas. Tal also holds the melodic body of the movement together and also gives shape to a raga. Tal has the sum, which is the beginning and the end of a rhythm cycle. Tal, in other words, is like the body of a raga.
Very well. Yeah, I've traveled a lot.
You have traveled quite a bit.
I've been hearing a lot of musicians from different gharanas. But there's some confusion.
What's that?
I find that some musicians from the same gharana, they sound different. They sound sort of got their own style.
Well, that's quite understandable. You see, you have to first know about the whole concept of how gharana system started. See, during the last few centuries, all these great musicians, they were under the patronage of the royalties in different states, different parts of the country, all cut off from each other. But since the independence, you know, when all the princely states were abolished, and all these musicians had to depend on the masses in the sense that they had to perform for the music conferences, festivals, sing for All India Radio, and things like that. In spite of the fact that they, the senior musicians, were not influenced, but the younger generation belonging to the gharanas, because of the media and the communication and everything, they had the opportunity to hear other gharanas, other musicians, and it was very natural for them to be influenced gradually, you know, to hear something nice which they like, and that sort of things crept in and got to mix up.
In modern times, it becomes impossible for an artist to remain true to his or her own gharana. Hence, we see a few artists who imbibe a few attractive features of other styles to enrich and nourish their own art. And one of the classic examples of this is the great Parveen Sultana.
Ah!
Indian music has continued unperturbed for 30 centuries or more, with an even pulse of a flowing river. Indian music to me is like a stimulant which invokes positive, beautiful responses in a human being, the beginning and the end, an integral part of one's life. Beautiful, harmonious, loving, and creative. I think that's it.
Guru Charan.